Heave I ho, the best man in Ottawa was Mufferajoe. Big Joe Mufferaw paddling the Mattawa all the way from Ottawa in just one day. Hey.
How's it going, eh? Enjoy being Catholic? Welcome to the show. Today we got old Tom Green on. He's still rocking and rolling, eh? I discovered him in 1988 when he was doing prank radio calls at the Ottawa U radio station. And I am 100% responsible for all of his success. We will be discussing that, and I assume I'll be getting a thank you. We'll also be talking to Jared Swilly from the Black Lips. We're going to be talking about the Canadian border. And I remember having bands stay at my house in Montreal. The border people are a nightmare. They have absolute power and absolute power corrupts, absolutely. And they keep ruining music for Canadians by stopping bands from coming up because, oh, they're going to take tons of money out of Canada. Yeah, we can have tons of refugees can come in, but bands can't? It don't make sense. And finally, Jason Jones from The Daily Show. He's got his own show on TBS now, as does his wife, Samantha Bee. And his show is called The Detour. I think, like, you know the way the South Park guys run Comedy Central because they're such a big part of the income there? I feel like Jason Jones and Samantha Bee run TBS comedy. And they're both Canucks. All Canucks except Jared on tonight's show. Jason is from Hamilton, and Samantha Bee, I believe, is from my hometown of the old Ottawa Valley, eh? We'll be discussing that with Tom, too. That the funny thing about leaving Canada and coming back to Ottawa is you realize how thick the Ottawa accent is. They sound like funny little Irishmen. Oh, look out. My kid is coming in here. What's going on? Oh, you like the Habs now, eh? You living in Montreal there, Mr. Turncoat now, letting the Senators down, eh? I miss it. Let's roll it.
Heave-I-ho.
Hi, Tom.
Hey, how are you, Gavin? Good to talk to you.
How's it going? How's it going, eh?
Go Habs there, eh?
Go Habs. And the Senators. I love the Senators, too.
Oh, yeah, absolutely there, eh? We love the Senators. Go Sens.
What's your toque there? Is that the Beau Brewery? They're doing your beer, aren't they?
Yeah, this is my Beau's Brewery hat. It's Ottawa's Beau's Brewery. They make the Tom Green beer. Let's start this interview off with a plug for my beer.
Plug away,
everybody.
Plug away.
It's a delicious milk stout, and you have to try it there, eh? It's more like, now we're like Bob and Doug McKenzie, right? We've got to talk beer. We've got our toques on there, eh? We're going to get her done.
How often do you get back to the Big O?
Oh, yeah. You know, I'll be up there this summer there, eh? I'm doing some shows up there at Yuck Yucks, and then I'm going to be at the Montreal Comedy Festival in July, so doing Just for Laughs, and I'm gonna actually have some good Ottawa time in the summer. I'm looking forward to it. Do you get back there to Ottawa much? Go out.
I do occasionally.
And go, you know, down to Barrymore's on Bank Street and the Royal Oak.
Oh, yeah. I used to be a dishwasher at the Royal Oak. No, when I go back there, I'm often stunned at how thick my friends' accents are. And I feel like this sort of like British aristocrat because I come in and go, hello, everyone. How are you? And they go, oh, check out McInnes there stumbling in there with a 2-4 under his arm. And I'm like, I don't understand you, leprechaun.
Yeah, it is interesting how it's because, you know, when I moved to New York, when I did the show on MTV, everyone started razzing me because I said A all the time. I didn't realize how much I said A. And then I'd be looking at videos that I'd edited, and like I would edit it where I would leave A in, you know, like, I was, like it was a perfectly fine opportunity to cut it out, but I didn't even notice it as being abnormal. But now I've stopped saying it. I've stopped saying A because, you know, we sold out, right? We sold out and moved to the States there, right?
Totally sold out. How do you pronounce the word A-B-O-U-T?
Oh, yeah. See, I think Americans exaggerate when we say a boot. I don't say a boot. I say about, which is still close enough to a boot, but about.
I actually am working on a documentary about the movie Das Boot called All About Das Boot.
Nice.
Thanks. Hey, Tom, I've been meaning to tell you this for years.
Yeah.
I discovered you.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. How so? No, exactly.
All right. Here's the deal. I was in a jokey punk band called Anal Chinook. And then you were in a jokey rap band called Organized Rhyme.
That's right. Yeah.
And I think you guys got some of the jokey stuff from us.
Yeah, we ripped it all off.
Okay. So that's
Let me say this. Let me say this.
Okay.
The cool thing I always have thought, the cool thing about growing up in Ottawa is, you know, when I was a kid, like a little kid before I was, you know, old enough to even be in a band, you'd see posters for like bands like Anal Chinook or Furnace Face or, you know, I was a skateboarder, so it was like Grave Concern. There was all these sort of skate punk bands. And I don't know if that was true necessarily, but I mean, maybe it was like that in every city, but I don't think it was. I think we had this kind of like absurd sort of music comedy thing going on that was probably different back then and ahead of its time. So, you know, that was inspiring for me. And I saw like all these other kind of punk rock bands and I thought, I kind of want to do that. So I started making beats and we started Organized Run. Yeah.
Okay. Now here's the real deal. I thought of you as like, you're younger than me. And I thought, oh, he's that kid in that funny rap band. Good for him, whatever. And then I was driving around Ottawa, at night, and I guess I was listening to CKCU in the car, and you had a radio show there, and you were taking calls. You took a call from a guy, and you went and got pizza with him. I think you actually coerced him into going to buy a pizza.
Yeah, CHUO, actually. Just represent.
CHUO.
CHUO, Ottawa University, 89.1 FM. Yes.
So you went in there. Now, this had to be 1988. And you made the guy hand the phone to the pizza dude. And then you said to the pizza dude, this guy's a murderer. Call the police. I'm in danger. He has me kidnapped at home. And then the guy got the phone back. And he's like, what did you just say to him? And I was driving around my car and I go, oh, my God, this guy has a gift. And then when I saw you next, I go, dude, I don't know you very well. I always saw you as a jokey, rappy guy. But you are going places. I promise you.
Nice.
I call that discovering.
You know, that kind of encouragement, you know, is what every kid needs when he's doing his college radio show to keep going through the tough times, you know?
Now, but I'm not saying you wouldn't have been successful without me. Like, someone can discover the light bulb if the light bulb's already discovered, but that doesn't mean you didn't discover the light bulb. It just means that Thomas Edison did it first.
Yeah. I remember those days on CHUO, how much fun it was, because the radio station had a cell phone. It was the first cell phone I ever saw. It was one of those giant, like, you know, you're calling in an airstrike kind of sized
phones. Wolf of Wall Street things.
Yeah, exactly. And so I really wanted to borrow that cell phone. And so they lent me the cell phone. And for the next, like, you know, year, I was hosting the show from, you know, in the woods. You know, I'd wrap my head in tinfoil and say, you know, come find me. I'm in the woods with my head wrapped in tinfoil. You know, we used to do these caravans where I'd drive around in my car hosting the show. I mean, I'd call into the radio station, I'd call into my own show, and then I'd have an engineer there put me on the air. And I'd just tell people to find me, and we'd follow. We'd do this caravan around the city. We'd drive past the prime minister's house and honk our horns and stuff like that. It was, technology was exciting back then. It was so new.
Well, here's my theory, though. I think you are who you are from birth, and we could have put Tom Green in Saskatoon or the Congo, and he would be sitting here right now with that parrot behind him.
Yeah, it would probably be a Congolese parrot. Yeah, no, I don't know. It's possible. I mean, certainly, you know, it's cool. Like, you know, I mean, talking about the radio show and going around with a cell phone and doing all that college radio stuff and the music stuff that we did back in the day in Ottawa. It's amazing to see how the world's come. And, you know, this morning, you know, I didn't even have Skype set up on my computer, and just kind of quickly we hammer this out. Now we're doing a two-way video chat. What's going on with the world, right? You're probably running this through a new tech TriCaster over there, and you know.
If I was smoking a joint, I would say it's all God, and it's this incredible, magical thing, like that video I Am Pencil, where they explain the free market and how it's amazing that a pencil is made. I think this has all been preordained.
Yeah, okay, well, that kind of takes a little bit of the fun out of it, really. I mean, that means I don't have to worry or do anything. It's just going to happen anyway.
Yeah, I just removed your free will. You're not responsible for your own success.
Okay. Yeah, I hope you're true. You're right, and I hope I start to believe that. That seems like it would make life a heck of a lot easier.
Well, you know, you can change it a bit, but 80% of who you are, who your brain is made at birth. Okay, last question. Are Canadians funny? Are we naturally funnier?
I think so, yes. I think so. I think when you are, born into sort of an underdog status, I mean, that's where most comedy comes from people that are kind of underdogs, maybe a little insecure. You know, when I was a kid, I was a skinny kid. I wanted to be the goofball in class. Well, Canada has a national, little brother syndrome, right?
Yep.
I also think, though, the fact that we're able to kind of do our punk rock bands and our comedy shows and our radio shows in isolation, completely out of America for years and years and years, and kind of develop what it is that we think is funny before anybody gets to see it, is helpful. And just growing up with Monty Python on the CBC every night, I mean, that's got to do something to your head, when you're 8 years old and you turn on the TV and SCTV is on every day and the kids in the hall and things like that. I mean, that's just got to mess you up a little bit.
Yeah, well, you can't go outside because it's cold. So you're watching TV for 6 months of the year. You end up becoming like a pop culture TV PhD.
Yeah, plus TV is... We've got some great TV in Canada, but we also always had the weird TV. You watch The Littlest Hobo enough times, that's going to make it funny.
Yeah, or the hinterland who's who with the Arctic beaver owl.
Yeah, exactly. And the Beachcombers and, Rocket Robin Hood and Hercules. I mean, remember that cartoon Hercules?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that was the worst cartoon ever, but it was on every single day,
True.
So I think that's messed us up, Gavin. That's why we're the screwed up individuals that we are sitting here with our toques.
Well, we're special, and special is often used a word they use for the mentally handicapped.
Hello.
I like you more than a friend, and I'd love to have you back on the show as soon as humanly possible.
Oh, yeah, Gavin, this is cool, man. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. Now, where are you broadcasting from, New York right now?
We're in Manhattan, yep.
You're in Manhattan, cool. Well, yeah, definitely next time I'm up in New York or when you're in L.A., let's get together and have a beer there, right? Let's get her done.
Let's get her done and get blasted, eh? Let's get totally hosed.
Absolutely. Cheers.
I love Alberta. I've lived here my whole life, and I'm proud of it. I'm proud of our free market, pro-business, low-tax, do-it-yourself attitude. And now, I'm watching my province get destroyed. We've all had hints of the NDP's radical views in the past, but no one actually thought they'd ever run this province. Not even them. And now they are. And the worst is yet to come. I give my sad forecast for Alberta in my new ebook, The Destroyers, Rachel Notley and the NDP's War on Alberta.
Want to have dinner with Faith Goldie? Grab a drink with Brian Lilly. Talk politics with Ezra. You can do it all on the Rebel Cruise. This November, join us for great debates, gourmet meals, and gorgeous scenery as we sail from Fort Lauderdale around beautiful Caribbean islands. It's an intimate week where you can really get to know your favorite Rebel personalities and meet other Rebel lovers too. Space is limited, so visit therebelcruise.ca to sign up now.
Heave-hi, heave-hi-oh. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce my best friend in the world. What's so funny? Oh, I'm not your best friend, but you're my best friend.
I guess so.
Oh, I hate when that happens. I'm like your seventh best friend. You're my top.
I usually keep a list. I'm down to like 12 now.
It's an Excel spreadsheet.
My 12th best friend.
12th.
Sometimes they switch.
Jared Swilly is the man, the brains behind the Black Lips. Aren't you the main songwriter guy? Is that a contentious thing to say?
It's all an equal effort.
Who wrote Dirty Hands?
Actually, Cole wrote that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so
that's your hit, right? Would you say that's your main hit?
They're all kind of hits.
Okay. Well, to me, that's the hit.
Okay. Well, yeah, Cole wrote that.
I was at a wedding where you played it.
Oh, yeah. We sucked at that so bad. Because I didn't realize that... Like, I just thought Scott was my friend's friend. I was like, oh, we're going to this wedding to play. And then we show up, and Cameron Diaz was there. I was like,
This
isn't a normal wedding. And we didn't ask for anything. We didn't have a place to stay. We went to the after party, and like all these celebrities were all skinny dipping in the pool and everyone's going getting ready to go to their rooms, and we were like, yeah, okay, I guess we're gonna go to our rooms too. We didn't have any rooms, and none of our friends from New Orleans picked up their phones, so we climbed to the roof of the hotel and just slept on the roof.
No way.
In our suits, and then it started raining like
6 a.m. Oh my God, that's grim. Yeah, you guys were dressed up that night.
I had to borrow a suit from here.
What do you mean from here?
From one of my friends here.
Oh, in New York.
Yeah.
I
didn't realize Scott was a big deal. And like,
he's a big deal. We're talking about Scott Campbell, the tattooist. He's done a bunch of my tattoos, and he's a tattooist to the stars.
Yeah. I didn't know that at the time. He was just a dude
I hung
out with.
Jennifer Aniston's tattoo, Johnny Depp.
Jennifer Aniston was at the wedding.
She was, very briefly. But more importantly, Canada.
I love Canada, but it's so hard to get in there. I've been to Iraq. I've been to Lebanon.
Really?
Been to some hard...
The Middle East is easier to get to than Canada.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, can we watch the potty mouth, please? This is a family show.
That's a paywall.
Yeah, for families. Okay. The other show is the potty mouth show.
Well, it's a very annoying country to get into, Canada.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because I played in bands as a young man, and I remember it was de rigueur for a band not to get through, or we have there's this one band called the Cheetah Chrome, I'm sorry, mother... And Bob Stinson was in the band. He was rude. This is Bob Stinson from the Replacements, who's now dead. He was rude to one of the border people. Nope.
They flag you. They'll flag your name forever. You know what I just found out? They flag normal names. Our drummer, who's never been in legal trouble. I've been in a lot of legal trouble. His name is Joe Bradley. They flag him forever, and they were like, yeah, it's because you have a normal-sounding name.
Really?
I still don't know why they do that.
So the Mike Smiths are screwed, too?
They're screwed.
That doesn't make sense. Well, the thing that drove me nuts about
I've been deported 6 times from that country.
6 times you've been deported from Canada?
Yes.
Well, I understand the mentality at the border, and that is you're coming here to make tons of money in my country selling grapple grommets, and then you're going to leave with $8 million, and that's bad for the economy. Totally get that. That's a rational thing to think. But bands,
their minds,
are making $300 a night.
Bands spend money. Most bands that go to Canada or vice versa, they spend money there and they generate capital while they're there. They're buying gas, they're buying cigarettes, they're employing bartenders, door guys. They're not coming back with a lot of money.
It's infuriating. The whole theory is based on this myth of a truckload of money leaving your country. And that, by the way,
because they think everyone that's in a rock band is Queen.
Yes. Yes, that's exactly. Now, you've brought along some of the paperwork it requires to get through the border.
A little bit, and I'm kind of a dick about it because I make double copies just so they have to sift through everything, because they're going to take usually 6 hours of my time.
It takes 6 hours to get through the border.
Usually, yeah. Wow. So I just slap them with this. It's like, let's go through that.
Let's look at this here. This is unbelievable for someone who... I mean, you're a very successful band, so you're going to be on the higher end of the spectrum of what you're bringing back. What's it going to be like?
Making money for your country.
A couple grand, maybe? I don't want to get too into your finances, but...
We can go up, but...
A median number probably for bands is maybe $500. Let's say you guys...
Let's say we're making $500.
You're bringing back 15 grand.
I wouldn't go to Canada if we were making $500.
So you have to... are these work visas?
No, it's I've been arrested a lot of times.
Oh, I see. So wait a minute. Don't hurt my argument. My argument here is that innocent people.
Oh yeah, no.
Get harassed.
Yeah, my.
I can't be saying criminals have to go through a lot of rigmarole.
No, I was a criminal. They've all been expunged so far. But no, now actually, good news is Canada and America are gonna stop that work visa thing requirement where you have to do that both sides. I can understand that with different countries, but Canada and America, there's not a lot of...
I don't even know why there's a border, to be honest.
Yeah.
But don't let me use you as the linchpin of my argument if you're a unique case.
I am a unique case, but the rest of the guys in my band are not a unique case.
And they all have to go through with that.
Oh, yeah.
And other bands have to go through.
Well, because we made a mistake when we were like 16. It was our first time going to Montreal, and we were crossing at St. Albans. And we didn't know that you had to have work permits. Like, we showed up at the border like, yeah, we're playing Montreal tonight. They're like, where's your work permit? We're like,
work permit?
What is that? I thought this was Canada. We can just go through.
I'm playing some
And they said no, and they detained us for hours. And then we had to go through customs on the U.S. side, which was BS because we're American citizens.
Yeah, you're just coming home.
It's like, well, they just kicked us out. We're in the same office. You're just sending us back
really
around.
Bureau is a French word, and it really is a bureaucratic country, and it's frustrating because it damages Canada. It damages entertainment there.
Yeah, because they lose so many bands going over there, and same way over here. It's like, oh, can't play tonight. Didn't make it over the border.
Canada, if you're listening, please take it easy on entertainers. I remember I was doing a comedy show in Calgary once. Todd Barry was behind me. They asked me, what are you doing here? I go, I'm visiting my friends. They're getting married. And then with Todd, he goes, I'm here to do comedy. He was there for hours, and he was probably going to be leaving their country with $120. Let's stop sweating the small stuff, Canada, and let wonderful bands like the Black Lips entertain you.
What are you trying to do? Worked hard for it.
Thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me. Proud of your boy.
Namaste.
Looking for the perfect gift? Did you know the Rebel.media has a store? Make a statement with a t-shirt. Have your morning coffee in a Fearless Travel coffee mug. There's even an Ezra Levant bobblehead. It's a one-stop shop for the perfect gift. And don't forget to pick up something for yourself. Go to therebel.media/store to find out more.
Gentleman Jason Jones.
Hi.
You remember him from The Daily Show. He is a Canuck from Hamilton, Ontario, which is 6 hours from Ottawa, where I'm from. Although, I don't know, you seem kind of Ottawa Valley-y.
Really? What does Ottawa Valley-y mean?
We're a jovial bunch, very Irish-y, like, oh, look at this guy coming in here. What do we got going on?
Sure.
Maybe you'd have a bake sale with some old ladies.
No, I've never had a bake sale.
You've never competed
in
cupcakes with old ladies?
I'm from a steel town.
Oh, I get
it. A hardened steel town.
Because like, you're the Bruce Springsteen of Canada.
That's right. That was the worst.
Born to a fighter in the deep south side.
Is there a Canadian Bruce Springsteen?
I got my first real six string.
Number 69.
Bought it at the five. By the way, in summer 69, you do the math and he was about 11.
Yeah, that's the old joke.
Oh, that's ancient?
That's an ancient Canadian joke.
Oops, embarrassing. Yep. Speaking of ancient Canadian jokes.
Do a joke about how Canadian teams, only there's two Rough Rider teams in Canadian football. That's a well-worn joke as well.
I did not know that joke. This is really, we're going to have to edit all this out. I like to look like I know what I'm doing on the show.
All right.
So you did The Daily Show.
Yes.
There is life after Daily Show.
Of course there is.
Your lovely wife, also a Canadian.
She is.
She from Ottawa?
She went to school in Ottawa. No, she grew up in Toronto.
Toronto.
Yeah.
And you two Canucks are kicking ass and taking names on TBS.
We own a network, yes.
You run the network.
Yes.
I mean, South Park runs Comedy Central.
Pretty much.
If Matt and Trey don't like you or you're rude to them, your show will just vanish. It's like The Firm.
You won't have a show.
Your credit cards, yeah.
If you're rude to them.
Your credit cards won't work. And you're that of TBS.
So far.
You control people's lives.
It could all go away, but yes.
The reservation at a restaurant won't be there anymore.
I actually think reruns of Big Bang Theory actually control TBS.
Yeah. Well, the Big Bang Theory controls television. Now, this TBS isn't available in Canada, but it's available, I believe, on the Comedy Network there.
The Comedy Network. I think they just call it Comedy now. It used to be called the Comedy Network. Now it's just, I think, just called Comedy.
Cutting to the point. Yeah. Now, tell us a little bit about The Detour.
Detour is a funny show that...
Can we pull up some of it while he talks? Add some color?
Yeah, because there's this blank monitor back here not showing anything.
No, that's my sidekick. It's like a cute thing. Remember when Craig Ferguson had a robot? I have a thing I call blank monitor. Yeah.
We're just pulling up the trailer again.
That's fine. But just you're going to talk about it, and they can see it in the back.
Okay. All right. It's you might want to compare it to National Lampoon's, but it's got more of a Hangover vibe to it.
Yes, it does.
It's a little more ribald than.
Well, it's pure chaos, and it reminds me of Three's Company in a lot of ways.
A little bit. There's a lot of misunderstandings.
And there's the same stress when you're watching it. Sometimes you're going, what? How are you going to get out of this?
There was a video I watched of a plane wings being tested, and how far it could bend. And it was the most stressful video I think I've ever seen. Those things can bend. Like when we go into turbulence and you see the wing going like a little like this, that's nothing to what these planes can do.
Oh, they can go right up.
They can go up to, like, I think they got it up to 60 degrees. It was an insane bend. And that was the sort of metaphor I had in my head when I was writing this show. How far can you bend a family before they break?
So it's like Alan Alda in Crimes and Misdemeanors. He says, if it bends, it's funny. If it breaks, it's not funny.
Yeah, I think it's pretty funny if it breaks, too. So then you can tape it back up. And
well, one thing I enjoy about the chaos on your show is that the protagonist, you, the dad, is not an idiot. He's not Homer Simpson. He's not the dude from Married with Children.
He's not an idiot. He's not a loser.
Right.
He's not bumbling.
Right. Jim Gaffigan's got a series of commercials out right now where he's not a total idiot, and it looks unusual.
It is. It's because that's all we know on sitcoms, our bumbling, sheepish dad and then scolding mom.
Scolding mommy.
Yeah. Oh, Nate.
You are a stupid jerk.
No, I wanted a partnership between a loving husband and wife that fight realistically and argue and bicker. And ultimately, at the end of the day, won't go anywhere because they truly love each other and know they can't do any better.
Right.
And that was the genesis of the show. And also, to create a show about people who like their kids, complain about their kids, but ultimately like their kids, which you never see.
You watch these things, I call them cuck-mercials, where the woman comes in and she goes, you didn't handle the auto insurance? And he goes, and she goes, you don't care about our lives? And you think, I don't talk to my wife like that, and she doesn't talk to me like that. No, that's not how people talk to each other.
There's a mutual respect in most relationships that is never shown on television, especially in the sitcom form.
Last observation, I was watching an episode of your show, The Detour, which is on comedy. And I have never seen a midget swim before.
I think they like to be called little people.
I've never seen a little person swim before.
Yes.
How did you pull that off? Because the sheer physics of it, you know.
It's difficult. It's difficult for them. We auditioned six people, and only one of them said they could swim. And he couldn't.
Wow.
So we had to have someone in there helping him.
Well, that's probably...
It's difficult to swim as a little person. It really is.
The two most unique things about your show are that dads are not idiots and little people can swim.
Kind of. They can kind of swim.
No, that's the show. Reality is totally different.
If that's the only takeaway from my show, then all right.
How did you do it? Did he have inflatables?
No, he just flailed until the preacher then jumps in.
Ah,
the Christian preacher who we sort of make fun of, but then ultimately saves the day.
So this actor from the chaos risked his life to help your joke.
No, that was part of the script. I wrote it.
I know, but he was in a real pool.
He
could have drowned.
Yeah, he could have. Well, it's not that deep, actually.
He was a hero.
The preacher.
Why are we not talking about this guy more? Why are we so obsessed with Jason Jones' contribution? If you want to see little people risk their lives to amuse us, check out The Detour on comedy. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you, Gavin. Is it Gavin?
I'm Gavin, yeah. Right. I'm just me, more Canadian. We're all...
This threw me.
You're a hoser deep down, are you not?
I divorced that hoser in me.
Oh, we don't want that in.
Sorry.
We've heard you loud and clear. You can't get enough Canadian conservative news and opinion. Why not check out our blog? It's all your favorite conservative bloggers together on a page called The Megaphone. Go to therebel.media/themegaphone or click on the megaphone menu from our main page to check it out.
Looks like we got a call from John in Toronto. John, are you there?
I sure am, Gavin. How are you today?
Good. How's it going, eh?
Pretty good, eh? It's a little cloudy here in Toronto, but everything's pretty good.
Right on.
I think you're the best man I can ask this question to. I'm writing some books, and what it is about Canada at its roots, you know, just core Canadian themes. But it's really damn hard to get anyone interested in publishing these books because they're not going with the standard multicultural narrative. You know, we're going back to the fundamentals here of the colonial, the Dominion, French and English, beavers, maple syrup, and all that sort of thing. So I want to spread that. I want to make Canada proud of some of its basic core things. How would you go about doing that?
That's a great question, eh? And I noticed that's a real problem
with Canada, historically, Brian Lilly talked about this back in Sun Media days, and he talked about the Museum of Natural Civilization, I think it's called, in Ottawa. And Ottawa is Scotland, okay? Most of Canada was founded by Scots and French, and there was not a huge Cambodian influence there. But
not as many.
In this museum, you have Chinese laundries in Winnipeg and the amazing Polynesian influence and the Black American influence. And you just go, this is not historically accurate, even if it makes you feel better. But my advice to you would be, if you're trying to get to talk about true Canadian heritage, is lie. Don't. Now, don't be factually incorrect, but be disingenuous about your intentions. There's a great book called, I think it's called War Before Civilization, and it's all about how brutal the American Indians were, how brutal Aborigines were in North America. I mean, there's no American, obviously, back then. And he talks about mass graves and shooting a victim with arrows after he's dead, so he'd be screwed in the afterlife. Now, this was an archaeologist who wanted money for this book and to do the research, and he had a lot of trouble getting funding because that's not part of the narrative. So he sort of flim-flammed it and indicated that he would be researching how even a culture that had this many troubles was still detrimentally affected by colonization.
Very clever.
And then, of course, he didn't deliver. So I think the only way to get the truth out about Canada to Canadians and, you know, to the political class, the media class, is to Trojan horse the truth in some sort of multicultural giant blanket that's not true.
That's a really wonderful idea. I've already written a couple of these things. And what I've done, which actually lends itself toward the direction you're already describing, is to make some things super fantastical. Like in the book of short stories I'm writing right now, Toronto is in danger of being flooded by giant beavers. And so everyone's trying to figure out a way to deal with that problem.
Wait a minute. So this is fiction you're worried about?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, just make the protagonist black. That's easy. Or Indian. Thanks for calling, buddy.
Okay, can I just make one more suggestion?
Okay.
A great Canadian book from the 1790s, Jonathan Richardson, Wakusta. It's all about an ongoing battle of Fort York. It's an extremely good, great Canadian book that everyone should know about.
Okay, thanks for telling us about it. See you later. Let's talk to old Tom in Saskatchewan's. Tom, are you there?
Yes.
Hi, Tom.
How's it going?
How's it going, eh?
Oh, yeah.
What's up?
So I've been hearing a lot of backlash, at least on my Facebook, a lot of people upset about Trudeau and the whole situation with the fire going on in Fort Mac right now. A lot of errors, not facts thrown out there. A lot of people getting really political about it, which is kind of sad. A lot of people lost their homes, and to try to turn it into a political statement just doesn't seem really right. But a lot of people complaining, well, Trudeau giving all this money to refugees and stuff and not really helping out anyone in Fort Mac, which is actually really far from the truth. The matching of Red Cross donations is in addition to what the federal government will pay. So it's going above and beyond what is really expected of the government. They're legally obligated to cover 90% of the damages to everyone with over $15 in damaged property, meaning that the matched Red Cross donations so far and the estimate so far of $9 billion, that is the average of over $41,000 in addition to the homeowners insurance of the people affected. So they're definitely doing a lot. People are criticizing him, saying, well, he should be down at Fort Mac, and he's not. But, you know, he's doing what he's supposed to be doing in his office. It just doesn't make any sense that he would be down at the fire zone and putting himself in danger when he can't really do anything from Fort Mac when he's taking care of all the funding and everything. So,
Tom, this is physically painful for me to do because I hate Trudeau, but I will give you
your voice, and your contention is that, no, he's not giving too much money to refugees. The money that he's matching with the Red Cross is on top of money they're paying, and that's 90% of everyone who has debt more than or damage more than $15. If what you're saying is true, that does sound pretty reasonable. Thanks for calling, buddy.